Thank you, Tree. First, just a volume check. We good? Down. I do tend to project. So can we take it? Can I take it down here, or do I need someone else to take it? Because I'm going to get excited today, and I'm going to talk really loudly. Where do I go to turn it down? Okay, let's keep going. How about that? Great. Yeah, so Melinda mellowed you right out, and I brought you right back up again, right? Thank you all for coming out on an early Friday morning. There's so much to talk about today. But before I get into that, I wanted to share two things with you really briefly. I was driving in this morning down the farm road, and I was looking out across this incredible pastoral landscape, as so many of you, I'm sure, did, and really appreciating seeing the cows that were grazing. You know, you see the herd of cows that was grazing up on the hill, and all the grass is, you know, right now it's just at its peak of summer lushness and vibrancy, and even some that early on there was a field that had been mown. And I was thinking about how it's really, sometimes I think we tend to get a little myopic in thinking about regenerative agriculture and grass-based farming and soil health and food as being about our physical well-being. And we forget what it means to our spirit and emotion. So I just want to try to, you know, something I'm going to hopefully we'll touch on later. But I really wanted to make sure to put that right out up front because I think that's an incredibly important component when we talk about agriculture and its impact on ourselves and on our communities. Let's remember that it's not just physical, it's not just economic, right? There's something much bigger going on here. So there's that. And the second, I also really wanted to thank David Hollenbeck. Is he here? David. How are you? I wanted to thank you for reaching out to invite me to this, and I wanted to share with you just a little passage from an email that David sent to me when we were sort of discussing what it was that we would be talking about today. So David said to me, "We want this to be the state that food saved. Not just food, but a healthy, nutrient-dense, grass-based food system that is regenerative, carbon sequestering, integrative, healthy farming, healthy people, healthy communities, environment, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera." So that is the task that is before me, right? And David, of course, is spot on. And I want to, it's Friday morning, it's Friday, come on. You know, cut me some slack if we don't touch on all those, but I think we will. Because one of the wonderful things about talking about regenerative agriculture is that you inevitably do end up talking about all of these issues. You begin to realize that none of these issues exist in a vacuum. The economics, the cultural and social implications, the spiritual well-being I spoke of, our physical well-being, these things are all interconnected in really, really profound ways. And I think one of the, you know, the real errors, I guess, of contemporary modern-day agriculture is that it sees these things as existing in separation, right? When in fact, of course, we know, I think everyone in this room understands, if not intellectually, intuitively, that these things do not exist in separation. So, logistically, I really like it when any of you, all of you, engage in the conversation with me. So at any point during this presentation, I really would encourage you to raise your hand if you have a question, if you have a thought, right? Please don't save it until the end. I find that sometimes the most rewarding and rich material comes when we have an opportunity to diverge and explore the questions and emotions that arise from some of these conversations in the moment. So just raise your hand if you have a thought, question. Yes, sir. Well, right off the bat. Okay. Not quite yet. No, go ahead. Yeah.
Well, I thought you were a little incomplete.
Oh, a little incomplete. Okay. Let's go.
Just more.
Oh, we'll get there. Oh, we'll get there. Yes. And I'd hoped we'd get there in part with this slide. For some reason, I've got a little corruption issue here. But in essence, what I was hoping to relate with this is to start talking about when we're talking about regenerative grass-based farming and agriculture, you know, what is it that we're really talking about, right? And one of the things that we are talking about is that the most regenerative, the most sustainable forms of agriculture is that which is based on perennial crops, and particularly those perennial crops that don't require disruption of the soil, right? So one of the most abundant perennial crops that we have access to is grass, right? There's grass growing everywhere. Does anyone here think that you can't eat grass? How many people here think that you cannot eat grass? You are mistaken, right? We are eating grass all the time. We only need to utilize ruminant animals to help us extract nutrients from the grass. Now, when we're talking about grass-based farming, we're not even really just talking about grass, of course, because grass does not exist in isolation from the soil and from the sun. So really, grass-based farming is just a way for us to turn sunlight into human fuel, right? To fuel our bodies. I think one of the things that is most detrimental about the current sort of atmosphere surrounding meat production in this country is, well, not only that 99.9% of meat production is deplorable, but also that there is this evolving, when we talk about the evolving awareness about how deplorable it is, we are also talking about a disconnect between what meat production can and dairy production can actually be, right? And so too often our awareness that we are the dominant meat and dairy industries and livestock industries are rapacious and horrifying in every which way, which is absolutely true, leads us away from meat and dairy rather than toward an understanding of a model that is actually one of the most sustainable forms of agriculture that we can engage in, which is utilizing these animals to capture sunlight via grass-based integrative farming. Right? Does that make sense to everybody here? I think I'm probably a little bit preaching to the choir here. You guys understand this. So grass-based farming gives us the opportunity to utilize animals to produce food and make nutrient-dense food out of sunshine. It gives us the opportunity to actually grow topsoil in a relatively short order with proper animal management. Grass-based farming is not just about meat and dairy, because, of course, one of the forgotten components of animal livestock agriculture is fertility. Right? There is no waste management issue if you are managing your livestock in the proper way, which, by the way, is almost always means manage them in the way that they would prefer to be managed, right? It's amazing that once you actually allow animals to express their innate natures is when they actually start doing the work for you, right? So all of the issues that have cropped up around meat and dairy production are of our own making. They're not of the animals' making. They're of our own making. And sometimes it occurs to me that all we really need to do, all we're really trying to do when it comes to this style of regenerative agriculture is make the common sense possible in an insane world, right? This is all incredibly common sense. The problem is that we're trying to implement in a world that's gone totally friggin' nuts, okay? So that's our job. That's our task right now. That's what stands before us. Is to implement the common sense. Right? Oops, wrong way. Mostly what I have here are some pastorals. I'm just going to sort of talk, and every once in a while we will all sort of, there will be something here to actually reference. But, you know, grass-based farming, cows grazing on open lands, utilizing. I'm sure you're all familiar with the idea of rotational grazing or mob stocking. Anyone not familiar with this? Okay, great. So I'm going to talk a little bit about how is it that we make this happen? How can the simple use of animals on the landscape actually benefit our soils, benefit our bodies, benefit our spirits, benefit ultimately our communities. Yes?
I've never heard the word mob stalking.
You've never heard the word mob stalking?
No.
Is it one word or is it actually two words? Who knows? Two words. Okay, two words. Mob stalking. So let's talk about a little terminology here, right? So there's a few different terms that are thrown around that actually in some ways are somewhat distinct from one another but are often used fairly interchangeably. Rotational grazing is one of them. Planned grazing is another. Mob stalking is another. Is there any other term for the management of livestock, the intensive management? Intensive grazing is yet another, okay? All of these terms are meant to imply some kind of purposeful use of animals on the landscape for the benefit of the landscape, the animals, and the people working with them.
Okay.
What?
Transhumance.
Transhumance.
Yeah. People migrating with their animals.
I had never heard that one. Transhumance. Okay. They all essentially mean one thing, which is that you are working in concert with your animals to improve all of the above aspects that we've been talking about. The health and well-being of the land, the soil, the health and well-being of ourselves, the health and well-being of the broader communities and the animals also. All of it means utilizing animals to forage intensively in relatively small areas before moving them on to another area of unforaged, ungrazed pasture, allowing this area to regrow, remembering that what is happening above the soil is also happening below the soil. Okay, so what you are trying to do is foment and encourage the regrowth and then die off via the application of animals on this grass, which in turn is building the soil as those root systems decompose, regrow, decompose, regrow. Okay. The key is never leaving them on one piece of ground for generally 3 days is considered the maximum. Some people who are really going after it and really trying to work with a piece of ground in an intensive way will move their animals multiple times a day. Okay, we move our animals twice a day, sort of a middle ground. Unless we're feeling lazy, then it's once a day. But there are tremendous benefits to this, and this is where we get into the fact that this is not just about the soils, this is not just about the animals' health and our health, this is about our communion with the animals that are under our care, that we work with, that are our partners, right? This is about that sense of observation and connection with the landscape that is so important to our spiritual and emotional health. This is about constant observation of your animals. This is about meaningful work. And it's not hard. This is the thing. We have created an agriculture and food system. We have created the difficulty in it. This is really easy work. This is really easy work. It takes me about 10 minutes twice a day. And I get to go out and walk across the pasture. Right? Could there be better work?
No.
Right. Yes. This is about bringing usefulness back to our human relationship with the world around us. Where are we? Let's just take a little bit of a big picture view here about how we're evolving, right? We are now entering the era of driverless cars, right? Pilotless airplanes, internet grocery shopping, drone-delivered Amazon goodies. What is going to be left for us to do?
Surf the internet.
Surf the internet, exactly, right? So, when people like to talk about sort of the drudgery, it's part of the sort of, I would say, misconceptions, one of the lies that we are sort of socialized to believe, which is that agriculture and growing food and this kind of labor has to be drudgery, right? And that we would all be better off being liberated from it. Shopping indoors, selling, creating an economy where I guess we sell apps to one another, little bits of digital technology, right? And buy in our food from out west and surf the internet in all our spare time. That's the liberated contemporary technological economy, right? I'd way rather be moving my cows. Way rather. And I bet most of you would too. And so when we talk about animal agriculture or any kind of agriculture, I think being drudgery, I believe very strongly that that is a story that we are sold. And that it does not have to be like that. Of course, we have created an agriculture system that is, in many ways, incredibly rapacious, and we don't want to work within, and no right-minded person would really want to be part of. But as most of us that are in this room, I think, are very aware, that does not need to be the way we do food. And yes, ma'am. We have six cows. But this is this is incredibly scalable. Right, there are people doing this with hundreds, if not thousands, of cattle in different parts of the world. Right, this does not have to be your six-cow bucolic homestead operation. This can be scaled to an operation that can feed thousands and thousands of people. There was another, Doug. Wow, right. Woo! Yes! Not a chicken in every pot, a cow for every Vermonter, right? But, yeah, so, that's something that I think Doug brings up a really interesting point right now, and I think it's something that I wanted to get to, but I'm going to get to it right now. Which is that it is really time for us in this state to kill a few sacred cows. And one of those sacred cows is the conventional dairy industry, upon which a huge percentage of our state's agriculture is based. And is responsible for, I think the most current figures say, 90, someone correct me if they know better, but 93,000 acres of GMO crops being cultivated in this state alone, right? For the purpose of what? For the purpose, what is the purpose? Money. Right? Money. And so you can quickly see how we start talking about grass-based farming and we start spiraling off into all sorts of huge sort of big picture issues because we have created a dairy industry, and I want to make a distinction between the dairy industry as a whole and the many really good, decent, hardworking people working within that dairy industry, right? None of whom are doing this because they're trying to do bad things for the land and the people living on that land. They're caught. They're trapped, right? And in economic circumstances that are compelling them in this direction. Yes? It could be any dairy. Generally not speaking of those. Generally speaking, we're talking about multi-hundred animal operations where the cows never see the light of day. And so this is the way the system works. The cows never see the light of day. And I don't want to spend all day talking about the dairy industry, but they are kept in confinement. By keeping them in confinement, you now have a waste management issue. Trying to get them to produce enough milk to maintain economic viability for the farmer when they're getting paid $14, $15 a hundredweight for their fluid milk requires feeding them a heavy feeder crop like corn, as part of their grain ration. This is where most of our issues are coming from in regards to GMO feeds, in regards to pesticides, herbicides, and fertility issues. And it requires harvesting that corn through mechanization, transporting it to the cow, bringing it to the cow. I mean, it's an insane system. It makes absolutely no sense. Yes, sir?
I do want to make the point that, as you were talking about scalability, that size, I've seen 20 cow dairies doing a horrible job.
Absolutely.
I've seen 1,000 cow seasonal dairies in New York State.
That's absolutely right. Yes. Yeah, so it is, it's not a matter of really big or small. It's much more a matter of, it's a practice-based situation. But what I think is fascinating, what is another piece of this picture, is that the products that are coming out of that environment which we are being sold as, skim milk, right? Being one of the biggest scams perpetrated on an unsuspecting public, probably, right? Since sliced bread, I don't know. But so what is skim milk? Well, that's what you get. That's what you get when the dairy industry skims all the nutrition off it, right? And sells you the swill and tries to convince you that it's good for you. And people believe it, right? So anyway, I don't want to focus too heavily on the dairy industry, but it is, from a commodity agriculture standpoint, it is one of the, you know, the biggest issues that we have. We have issues right now, you know, with tremendous amounts of phosphorus and nitrogen runoff in this area, part of the state in particular. We have a state government that is afraid, really, to go out on too much of a limb because the industry is really important. But we do need to start opening our eyes to what's really going on. And let's be clear, there are other forms of agriculture. There are many ways, I think, in which the nascent local food movement is not really necessarily serving us. And we can talk about those, too. But the dairy industry is huge, and we need to start talking in really honest terms about what that means for our health and well-being of ourselves and our communities. Yes?
Is the market GMO labeling
legislation? Sure. Yes. No. Not, I mean, not passed, but I mean, where are we at with it? Not for animal products. So the labeling passed for the consumer end-use products, but it's not for dairy and meat. So animals can still be fed GMO crops, right? And the product of those animals does not need to be labeled. So your milk from cows that were fed GMO crops does not need to be labeled. And one of the problems, I think sometimes we think about GMOs as being primarily an issue in the end product for our physical health, which is potentially really true. But I would also really encourage us to think about what GMOs mean in regards to farming practices and what those practices are doing to our land base. Because to me, that's potentially the much bigger issue and the one that's almost never discussed, which is that, you know, they are allowing and creating an environment in which detrimental agricultural practices are the norm. Okay? Yes? Mm-hmm. Oh, sure. I mean, corn's not meat. She was asking about, what? Give me an example of a product that you're talking about. Right. Okay. Mm-hmm. Right. Well, all that means is they're not being fed animal byproducts, right? So they're not being fed actual animal products, but they're still being fed crops that almost, unless they're organic or certified GMO-free eggs, are almost certainly GMO products. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. So I mean, and you know, this brings up another point about. You know, sort of labeling and transparency. One of the beauties of a grass-based regenerative system like we're talking about is that it's all out there in the open for you guys to see, right? So we don't need all these labels to tell us, and mostly to mislead us, about what a product is or is not. So the notion that, for instance, free-range eggs, I mean, all that means is that those birds have some sort of access to some sort of outdoor pen, which generally will be, you know, pecked to the consistency of concrete, and which they generally do not avail themselves of anyway. So, free range in relation to what you might see on packaging means almost nothing in the contemporary American food landscape, unfortunately. This is what Melinda was talking about a little bit earlier when we did that beautiful sort of sound experience, which is this understanding that as we are comprised of all of these organisms, these literally billions and billions of organisms, right, it is now, I think, fairly common knowledge that the human body contains 10 times as many bacterial cells as it does human cells, right? So that we are more they than we are us, right? The same is true of the soil beneath our feet. We tend to think of soil as something inert. Clearly, culturally, we have seen it come to think of it as a place to dump our waste. On the way up, I was listening to NPR, and they were talking about fracking, right? And they were talking about, I guess the EPA just said, you know, it's not really a problem after all, because as it turns out, there aren't really that many contaminated wells. Okay, maybe that's true, maybe that's not. I don't know. I suspect it's not as true as they would like us to believe. But maybe that's not the point. Right. Maybe our soil and the ground beneath our feet should be considered so sacred that we would never consider dumping all those chemicals into it. Yeah. Never. That's what we're talking about. Right? So often I find that we get distracted by these small picture views, right? And that we are sort of, I think, and sometimes encouraged to get distracted, rather than sort of backing up a minute and saying, wait a second. Everything in this room is soil. All of us are soil. The chair you're sitting in is soil, right? Why do we not, it's a living entity. Why do we not consider it to be one of the most sacred substances on the face of this earth? And why is that not part of a national conversation about our present condition and our future condition? That's a rhetorical question. Actually, maybe it's not a rhetorical question. Anyone have an answer to that? How about in the back? Okay. Yes. This would be in healthy, this would be in healthy, biologically active soil. So that's correct. Yes. Wow. Okay. How about right here?
I'm just wondering, were you getting that soil analyzed?
Yes, we were. Yeah. So I haven't talked too much because I've really wanted to make some bigger picture connections. So I haven't talked too much about sort of what we do on our property to sort of make sure that we are, you know, working in reverence and working with our soils rather than just working our soils. In fact, I never talk anymore about working the land. It almost always feels to me like we're working with the land, you know? And I almost can't even bring myself to think about it in that way. It feels much more like a partnership than, but yes, these are soil samples that we sample our soils not as frequently as we used to because we've gotten to a place with our soils where that we feel like they are really healthy and biologically active. But as we were going through this process of transitioning from sort of simple organic practices to more sort of biologically friendly practices, we did a lot of soil sampling. These are going out for broad spectrum analysis mostly for minerals, different minerals, to see where, you know, what we need to add and amend with to rebalance them. Yeah. So part of our work, you know, is involving animals are a huge part of our work with the soil. But because we are in such a depleted state with our soils, almost universally, frankly, we are also amending with minerals on a less regular basis now, but like 5 years ago, on a very regular basis. Yes?
Mobstocking.
Yo, we never got there. Right. Did you want me to talk about mobstocking for a second? Sure. So, yeah, we got distracted. This is what happens, right? This is such a big issue. You can go anywhere. So, rotational grazing, mobstocking, intensive grazing, planned grazing, humus particularis or something, whatever Doug was talking about. Transhumos. Thank you. Thank you. So, again, the idea of mobstocking itself generally refers to using larger numbers of animals to create a very intentional impact on a piece of pasture before moving them off that pasture. So it does numerous things. Like I said, it encourages the regrowth, it encourages the rapid decomposition via digestion, ultimately. It encourages the growth of topsoil via that decomposition process. Get the animals off there, it encourages the rapid regrowth of that forage, You bring them back again, generally, depending on the time of the year, anywhere from, say, 3 weeks to 6 weeks, depending on when you've achieved that regrowth. The animal impact, actually, in those short-term high-impact areas is actually incredibly beneficial to the soil. Doug, Doug's been practicing this for probably as long as I've been alive. Give me like two other reasons to do this.
You covered them all.
Oh, I got them all, right? So, and as someone who works with animals, I can't overstate the benefit of actually being observing them, being sort of forced to observe them twice a day, because it allows you to see when an animal is perhaps sick or injured. It tells you when your animals are in heat, which is really beneficial if you're in the business of breeding. And it, for me anyway, is simply rewarding. So planned grazing, rotational grazing, I think generally refers to perhaps not the intensity of animal application because maybe you don't have the same numbers. I would not consider what we do to be mob stocking with six cows. It's a small mob. It's a very benign mob, right?
May I ask one other question?
You may, yes. So consecutive grazing. So you would take your cows and you would run the sheep right behind them, and then you might run your chickens right behind them, or vice versa. So that the idea behind that is that there are certain species that the cows are going to leave behind that the sheep might favor. They will come through and clean up after them. The challenge from a pragmatic standpoint that presents is that different species of animals require different types of fencing, generally speaking. So the single strand of fencing, the picture is back there far enough, I'm not going to go back to it, but the single strand of fencing that makes mob stocking so simple with cows does not work for sheep. All right, so it becomes, we have not personally done much of that, just simply because of the pragmatic aspects of fencing. But I know some people have to great success. We are seeing reliable declines in the nutrient density and balance of our foods, right? Even the USDA, which is not exactly the most forward-thinking organization in the world, recognizes this, right? Much of this is due, of course, to our practices, our agricultural practices. Much of it is due to the fact that we simply don't seem to care as a society, so we're not demanding better. We'll talk about that in a little while. There we go. Oh, you want that one back? Okay, it was kind of nice. There we go. I want to talk a little bit, and this is where we start again, zooming out to get a little bit more big picture about the relationship between agriculture, the food we eat, and the medicine we take. Which is a much more tight-knit and cozy relationship than I think is very beneficial to us. And let's look at what's going on right now. 1 year increases in pharmaceutical categories, 2010 to 2011, so they're pretty recent. Antidepressants, 13% rise in 1 year. Drugs to treat ADD and ADHD, 17% in 1 year. Americans comprise 20% is wrong. We comprise 4.6% of the global population. I don't know where 20% came from. We consume 80% of the pain medication. Right? Whoa. That's a lot of pain. We're spending $174 billion annually to treat diabetes, and the CDC predicts a 50% increase in diabetes by 2050 to 1 in 3 Americans. There's an 800% increase in adolescent depression over the past 50 years. So you look, and perhaps the clearest correlation is in the diabetes figures. And you see now a relationship between pharmaceutical industry profits. Diabetes is right up there with statins, right? Right up there with behavior modification drugs, which must be taken on a regular basis, which, generally speaking, will keep you just alive enough to keep eating the crap that's making you sick so that you need the drugs to keep you just alive enough to keep eating the crap that's making you sick? Right? This is a friggin' windfall. This is a windfall. Yes? Well, there you have it. Right. The statins are a causative factor in diabetes, too. I'm not suggesting that there's necessarily a bunch of people meeting in a room and figuring this all out. But there might as well be. Oh, so, okay. So, whoa. You guys are crazy. Listen, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether there are people designing this or whether I call it sort of a conspiracy of circumstance. That's what I actually believe. You know, that our economic conditions, our economic expectations have led us to this place where we need cheap food and demand cheap food, right? And now we have the drugs to treat us for the condition. Yes.
Well,
go ahead. That's a really great point. Yes.
And this really tells the story. And I think Maria Angel, who was the editor for the New England Journal of Medicine for 20 years, and I think of the research she saw going back and forth, she said, you can never medicate your way out of a situation you've behaved your way into.
Right. That's a great. So you can never medicate yourself out of a situation. Now, and here is where we run into this issue that's so common sense. And we need to try to apply that. How do we apply that common sense thinking to a system that has gone totally insane, right? To a system in which, you know, we in this room, we're the fortunate ones. You know, we're not literally the 1%, but it doesn't matter. We're close enough because we're here in this room having this conversation on a Friday when millions of our fellow Americans are struggling at, you know, a minimum wage job, right? That is what we're up against, is trying to implement the common sense in an insane system. And so it's a system that traps people into that way of thinking, into that way of life.
Just like the dairy farmers.
Just like the dairy farmers, right? Right. Yes, in the back. Thank you. I really appreciate that comment, because one of the points I wanted to make, but probably would have forgotten if you hadn't brought that up. Well, remember earlier when I was talking about how if you allow an animal the freedom to express its nature, that is when it really starts to thrive. That is when it really starts to become part of a vibrant, regenerative ecosystem. The same is true of us, right? The exact same is true of us. And unfortunately, we live in a system right now where very few of us feel, I think, at liberty or even have any kind of sort of clear understanding of how we go about doing that, right? Most of us grow up, you know, essentially being institutionalized through an educational system for the majority of our young lives, and we enter into adulthood, not even really sort of considering that there might be a different journey, a different path. Often very confused, not everybody, but often, a lot, a high percentage. So again, you see that when you start talking about regenerative agriculture, you think, oh, we're just gonna talk about local food systems and, you know, local food economies and blah, 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 blah. And all of a sudden, you quickly zoom out and you have this incredibly, you can't escape talking about much bigger picture issues. Yes?
When you made that comment about the animals, my first thought was the children. When we bring children outdoors and let them play,
right,
they play, they explore, they get along,
yeah,
they grow, they develop, they wonder.
49 hours per week is the hours of screen time the average American school child passes every year, 49 hours, right? remember that statistic from before, 800% increase, 8 times rate of depression in adolescents over the last 50 years. Now, someone will tell you, well, we've just gotten better at diagnosing it. That's what the drug companies want us to believe, right? We've gotten better at diagnosing it, and it's no problem because we can treat it. Even better, right? So, these are just some pictures. You know, hey, it's the best damn food you can't eat, right? It really is. And again, you know, speaking of children and, you know, of meaningful work and giving human beings an opportunity to feel useful in this world, you know, all of these aspects of grass-based farming and regenerative agriculture and food, they provide these opportunities for us. We're not locking the cows away in the barn. We're not using, forget about it, but we've gone there already. You know, I think ultimately, when we talk about these issues of health and well-being, it comes down to sort of shifting our focus away from seeing our healthcare system, our disease care system, as being our provider, and seeing the land as being our healthcare provider, right? That's what we're talking about. This land is our healthcare provider. There was a couple hands up before that. Yes, go ahead. Right. Well, that argument is going to persist. I mean, there is a tremendous amount of money behind that argument. Let's put it that way. And there's a tremendous investment, there's a lot of inertia behind that movement and that understanding of that view of healthcare. You know, we'll talk a little bit, I'm hoping we get to, you know, talking about, like, what are the barriers to creating a healthy, regenerative, grass-based food system, and how do we start go about dismantling those barriers? Because that, to me, right now, is the big issue, right? I mean, first of all, we got to sort of understand what we're talking about. Right, and we don't all have to be in exact agreement. It can mean different things to different people. There are certainly going to be some commonalities, but it can mean different. You know, we don't all have to be following the Weston Price diet. We don't all have to be, you know, eating a particular way. But there do need to be some commonalities. I think we're probably pretty close to being there. The next step is to understanding what these barriers truly are and how do we begin to dismantle them. Yes. Yes. Yeah, we'll get there. I agree, 100%. These are just a couple more examples of, you know, utilizing animals. How animals, if you take them out. I realize I probably shouldn't be talking about confinement when I've got these chickens behind this fence here. But, you know, this is a chicken tractor that we use to run through our gardens at the end of the season, clean up the gardens, take care of any potential lingering, if there are any pest issues, which we haven't had much of in the last few years. Again, it's like the chickens will do this work for us. You know, we don't need to go out there and do that. We can do this with our chickens. We can feed them. Pigs, clearing land with pigs. Really, really great, simple process, right? This is it. This is like a 4-part series. you know, week zero, day seven, day, I don't know, 14, seat it down, and that's what it looks like about 4 weeks after that. Right? Yes? Oh, it depends so much on, again, the healthier soils and the vibrancy of your pasture. I would say, you know, if you have a good, healthy, lush pasture, an acre per large ruminant animal will do it. You won't be putting up your hay for the winter, but that will do it for your summer grazing. We have our six cows, and again, it's like, you know, this time of year, we can't keep up with the grass. It's like, oh, we got so much grass, we'll be grazing into December. And then all of a sudden it's August, and you're looking around, and you're like, whoa, we better start slowing it down here, you know? So it's amazing, you start to see. This is another wonderful aspect of this style of integrative animal agriculture, is that you get to be an observer of your surroundings, not just the land, but the climate, the entire ecosystem, in a way that you aren't if you don't have that level of engagement. In D.C.? Sorry. None that I'm aware of, but there may be. There may be. Yeah, right. And they got a lot more money. They got a lot more money. Right. Yeah. This is just another example of utilizing animals to take care of a task that would otherwise generally require either a good bit of scything or some combustion technology. So we're mowing our blueberry patch with our layers. Boom. Simple. And fertilizing at the same time. Again, you get the animal out on the landscape. They do multiple jobs for you, and they relieve you of the burden of a whole lot of labor, right? So this is actually, we're talking about labor-saving devices. These are labor-saving devices right here. Those are chickens. Yeah. Yeah. Did you have a question, sir?
Yeah, on an offtake of what you were saying, it reminds me of the cigarette industry. When will the states start to realize that this is inviolable?
It's going to it's bankrupting the system from the bottom up, right? Because it's bankrupting our land base, and because we are ultimately dependent on our land base, it's bankrupting us. Absolutely.
And, I mean, pretty soon they won't be able to afford it.
So, okay, well, I'll just plant this little seed, and it correlates to what she was saying. But, you know, it is up to us in this room here, and those of us that we know who have the capacity to do so, it is up to us to begin to try to create the conditions in which the style of agriculture that is bankrupting us and our land base is no longer viable because there's a better alternative, right? There's something more compelling. Which one?
What you call convention, it's sort of bankrupting itself.
That's a really good point. It is sort of bad. I mean, you know, it's interesting. And I live in Cabot, which I'm guessing that per capita there's more dairy farms in Cabot than any town in North America. I think there are 14 operational dairy farms in Cabot, a town of about 1,200 people. All but two of those are shipping organic. I'm not saying organic dairy farm is a panacea. There's all sorts of things wrong with contemporary organic dairy farming. But what I'm pointing out is that only two families, I believe, in Cabot are still shipping to Agrimark, which is the parent company of the creamery that actually bears the town's name, right? And it's because the conventional dairy industry is, as you're saying, doing a really good job of disincentivizing farmers from participating in it. That's true. That's a really good point. I'll be right with you. Yes. I just want to make sure we have the opportunity to talk about some of these barriers. I just want, you know, this is what we're talking about here in terms of, you know, the foods that we're trying to produce. Cream that will not pour. Right? I love me some cream that will not pour. You don't even have to churn it. You just, like, spread it on toast. Right? Interestingly enough, I can't sell you this food. I'm sorry. Right? I can sell you this food, but I got to jump through all sorts of ridiculous hoops to do it. Right? Butter. Right? Raw milk butter from the grass flush. I can't sell you this food. I'm sorry. You guys all know about the cholesterol myth, so we don't have to talk about that. Nice soft cheeses. Yep. Pigs raised on pasture, again, doing their good piggy job of converting a kind of scrubby piece of woodlot to actually vibrant pasture. They were eating, interestingly enough, they're eating sunshine in the form of milk, right? Sunshine that has been converted to grass through the magic of photosynthesis, that has been converted to milk through the magic of the ruminant animal, right? Grass farming. My pigs are eating grass right there. Again, I want to just tell you a brief story about meat processing and how it pertains to our local food economy, and how it is one small step toward making this truly nutritious food available to the common person in this state. So we started cutting our own pigs about 6 years ago or so. And we mostly started out of curiosity. Like, we just wanted to learn how to do it. Of course, this is highly illegal, doing this for anybody but ourselves or non-paying family members. And so it's pretty common knowledge that if you send an animal out to get butchered or to get cut at a butcher, you'll get back about 65%. Of the carcass in terms of yield. So you send in a 200-pound pig, you get 130 pounds worth of cuts back from the butcher. That's a very, very common figure. It can vary a little bit up and down. But so after we'd butchered a few pigs, I started noticing that the pile of scraps that we had was really, really small. It did not look like 35% of the animal, right? And so I decided to start weighing and to see, like, what was our yield? And we were getting about a 98% yield. And so I don't say this to disparage the hardworking meat cutters of the state who, again, like our dairy farmers, are simply trying to work quickly enough so that they can operate and be competitive, right, in an environment, in an economic environment that does not really allow them to take the time to sort of get that kind of yield. We can take that kind of time. The point I want to make is that when you're trying to raise this kind of meat, and if you're selling it by the half, right, by the hanging weight to your friends and neighbors, and they're only getting back 65% of what they're paying, right? So if you're selling on this kind of communal level, you generally sell by the hanging weight. So that would have been 200 pounds. Let's say they're paying $5 a pound. Now we're at $1,000. If they only get back 65% of that, their outlay, their cash outlay relative to the amount of meat they're actually getting, their price per pound goes through the roof. So this is just one small way in which contemporary food regulations are making it difficult for truly nutritive food to be accessed by the majority of people in this state. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
Yes. Oh, from the butcher? Yeah, it's a speed situation. So they're working really fast, and so they can't take the time, to worry about little scraps that might fall off the table, or if you're boning something out, they're working so fast they just don't have the time. They're trying to, you know, they're charging 70 cents or 65 cents a pound, cut and wrap fee, in order to remain competitive. Again, you know, they're operating in this economic sort of vacuum where it's all through the lens of economics, and they're trying to maintain that speed and efficiency so they can remain competitive. right? I mean, almost every issue we have with this, and this is another one of the huge sort of challenges that we face. Almost every issue we have with food in contemporary American society is that we think of it almost strictly in economic terms, right? Even in this state, when you hear the state talking about the vibrancy of the local food system, it's all about jobs. It's all about money. That is how we have come to think of it. I'm not saying that those are not necessarily important factors, but if they become our sole basis for determining whether or not it's working, we really risk undermining all sorts of other aspects of a regenerative food system. Yes? And ditto for healthcare, absolutely. Ditto for anything, really, you know? Yeah, well, okay. Sure, sure. I can't tell you because I can't tell you, I can't talk about that because it would be illegal if I were to admit what we do. No. I'm sorry, did I just say what we do? Yes, we are viable. We are viable. And we are able to provide people with more meat for the same amount of money. Yeah. You know, and at the same time, realize more profit for ourselves.
Economically, it works
on a very small scale.
Yep.
Very small. You know, we do about 6 pigs a year. Very small scale. You know, yes, again. Yeah. Right. Are you asking for our particular story, or are you asking for a more general sort of? Sorry, I'm not laughing at you. No, I'm sorry. Okay. Okay. So the short answer. I'm going to try to give you. I don't know where we're at with time, but I'm having so much fun. I hope we can go the rest of the day. The short answer is I was fortunate enough to drop out of high school, right? So I got off of that treadmill. I didn't know I was fortunate at the time. I was just stoned, right? I mean, let's be honest, right? But I got off of that treadmill, right? Spent a number of years casting about, ended up meeting a great woman. We lived in a tent on friend's land in December, saving for money to buy our property. I was making $8 an hour. I think she was actually out earning me at like $9.50 or something like that at the time. We were really fortunate enough to be able to buy land before land. We bought 40 acres for $30,000. We built our own house. Again, so this comes back to, you know, we were lucky because we had the skills. So one of the things I did after I dropped out of high school was I worked on various construction crews. I'm no master craftsman. You don't want to hire me to build your house, but I can build a house, and I built my own house. And we were fortunate enough to have our own skills. We built it largely out of pocket. We did take out a small loan. So you begin to see how, like, you know, one thing begets another, at least in our case. And that's our personal story. Now we are really fortunate that I'm, you know, there's a whole lot of images I have in another presentation I do that's sort of more encompassing what we're doing on our homestead. Involving, you know, lumber, production of lumber, involving production of fuel for our, you know, we pay ourselves to provide the things that most people pay others to provide for them. And that allows me the tremendous luxury and privilege of being able to write for a living, to be here standing talking to you, to be doing things like smoking my own bacon in a hole in the ground, right? I do get that these are privileges. But they are privileges that arose out of tremendously conscious decisions that it did involve at least some degree of hardship on our part, like poking the snow off the roof of the tent so it didn't collapse on us, that kind of stuff, you know? And I know this is not possible for everybody. I get that. Of course, not everybody wants to do this either, right? Not everyone needs to. Right, yeah. Yes, and then yes. Right. Yes, right. Yeah. Uh-huh. Well, I mean, we need these workarounds desperately, right? But you know what we need even more? Is we need to not need these workarounds, right? That's what I believe. All this stuff, this is just sausage making. That's blood we caught from a sticking wound on a pig. These are things, these are products that we cannot legally sell to our neighbors. Why? Why can't we do that? There has not been ever in the history of Vermont, at least as recorded by the state agencies, any case of foodborne illness associated with on-farm slaughtered meat, right? All of the issues with foodborne illness related to meat have been in relation to meat that's come from inspected facilities. So by that logic, we should be banning the inspected facilities, right? I mean, listen, I'm not saying that I can guarantee your safety. I can't. We can't do that. That's ridiculous. That would be ridiculous. But I am saying that your chances of getting sick from this, actually, and the most recent deaths in this nation associated with milk are from pasteurized milk, by the way, right? So let's be really clear that the risk here is incredibly low. Let's also be really clear that the Agency of Agriculture's primary objective is to protect the Vermont brand, right? Not the Vermont people. This is where we start getting to, how do we start to erode these barriers? I know there was one more question. If you can hold on to that for just a second, I want to make sure we get to some things. I mean, let's look at what we are allowed to consume. What else? You can go get yourself a Happy Meal if you start feeling depressed about any of these. If you start feeling angry, you can go out and shoot an automatic machine gun with your 10-year-old son. This is a perfectly legal pastimes. I'm not saying they shouldn't be. They should be legal. They should be. But so should this. Right? What else? If you get really despondent. Right? I know most of you are thinking, that looks like a pretty good time. Right? It's Friday after all. What's that? She's only 40. This is my wife, Penny, before we got on the nutrient-dense Western Price diet. My point being, again, if you want to smoke your way into oblivion, drink your way into oblivion, go for it. Go for it. But don't tell me I can't sell you a package of pork chops. Friggin' A. This is where I start getting pissed off. I'm serious. And I really believe very strongly, that this culture of oppression around our food is what is the primary barrier standing between us and the regenerative food system that David laid out, and for it being the state that food saved, right? If that's what we're really shooting for. This is the primary barrier. It's creating cost barriers. It's creating barriers of consciousness, because we just don't have a connection anymore to our food, because it's all been taken under lock and key, right? Our food has been locked up, literally and metaphorically locked up. Let's see. That's just to show you, we don't just eat meat and dairy. But again, you know what? These are all products of grass farming. And they're products of grass farming because this soil that grew all these was fertilized with the manure that came out of our cows. Right? So understanding these connections, that ecosystem, something that on a cultural level, we've totally lost touch with. All this idea is that, like, veganism is the most sustainable diet known to man. How the hell are you going to fertilize your quinoa? Right? Sorry. Actually, you're probably not. You're probably going to, you know, buy your quinoa in from where is it? In the Andes is where it's primarily grown, right? Where it's creating all sorts of social upheaval, right? I don't mean to go off on quinoa or vegans or anything. I know some really great people who eat quinoa. They're not happy. They're not happy, but they're nice people. Yeah. Yeah. Right. Sure. Uh-huh. Right. Right. And so they're going to tell you that, and then they're going to go mow their expansive lawn instead of put cows on their lawn to turn that grass into food. Anyone here mow their lawn?
Yeah.
Stop! You don't need to mow your lawn. That's food. Would anyone, you know, anyone here till their garden? Really? The next time you till your garden, I want to imagine a rototiller running over you. Because you're doing the same thing to your soil that that rototiller is going to do to you. I sense you weren't finished, sorry. Yeah, I get it. Right. Yeah. I mean, there's even a place for vegetables. Usually a small pile alongside you. No, you know, I think, but what you're getting at is that, again, that perception is based on an understanding of meat and animal food product production that is in itself rooted in the dominant paradigm, right? So there's what I'm saying is, if we're talking about regenerative food systems that are going to do all the things that we need them to do for ourselves, you know, physically, spiritually, psychically, whatever, for our communities, for the land, for the animals, you know, yes, we are not looking at that paradigm. We are looking at something totally different. Oh boy, yes. How much more time can we take? Anyone know? Keep going. All right, we're rocking and rolling here. We got right. Yes, in front. Sure.
If there was a balance, I think there would be a balance in, you know, the way that animals are, you know, land is used for animals.
Yes, I tend to agree with you. Actually, it's interesting. We are obviously big into sort of the Weston Price traditional food sort of diet, you know, ideology, if you will. We eat a lot of meat. We are finding as we age, we're not needing as much meat. We're just not desiring as much, mostly because I think we're just not desiring as many calories. So our meals are getting smaller. We are incorporating meat more into, like, vegetable dishes. And meat becomes, you know, an ingredient rather than a main course. So to a certain extent, I do agree with that. I think that's true. Yeah, yeah. Shelby. Well, I'm going to get there. I'm going to get there.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah. Right. All right. Yeah. In the back. Yes, sir.
So I get the sense that much of your family's livelihood is supported by our soil and the animals and crops. And maybe you're selling some to friends or family. I don't know. I'm not that sure. I don't know. I don't worry about that.
Uh-huh. Yeah, I mean, if we were to say decide that we needed to be fully compliant with modern, food regulations. None of our meat, because we are not willing to ship animals for slaughter. And we are no longer, at least in the case of pigs, which we are perfectly capable of butchering at home, we are no longer willing to absorb that 30% or whatever loss. We find it to be not only economically unsustainable, but disrespectful to the animal itself, right? Beef, we do still send out to be cut, just because we're not just capable of dealing with that size of a carcass. So no meat. Dairy, of course. I mean, and let's be clear, we have made some progress in the state, thanks to organizations like Rural Vermont, which I do encourage you to... they are here, and I do encourage you to visit their table if you want more information, but Rural Vermont is really the only organization in the state, you know, that is actively lobbying for the type of regenerative agriculture that I'm talking about, and not just in economic terms, but understanding the need for this to be an issue of justice, not just economy, right? We have made some progress with dairy, and recently there has been some loosening of the restrictions around raw milk, and so that's progress. We don't sell any of our milk just because we're greedy. We do sell some fruits and vegetables, and of course that's not really an issue. But it's the meat for us that brings the most. It's not just nutrient dense; it's cash dense, frankly, in terms of it's value dense in terms of what the market will bear. And particularly because we're utilizing this system whereby our pigs are being fed on milk that would otherwise, well, we would probably spray it on our pasture for our soils, and we do some of that. But they're being fed on what would, in most circles, be considered a waste stream food source. I don't know, cash-wise, I mean, we don't make our livings, we're not professional farmers. It is an important part of our income, financial income, but it's, you know, for us, we have just sort of, this stuff is so important to us that we have decided to orient our lives around it, and that we're going to figure out how to make it work one way or another. So we tend not to think of it too much in terms of economics. We have that luxury. As I spoke of earlier, I consider that a real privilege. You know, we've worked really hard to earn that privilege, but it's still a privilege. I get that, you know. Yes? Priority is great. That's great. Yeah, and so one of the things, you know, that I on that early page that was all, for some reason, I had a little bit of a text issue. One of the things that was on there that I forgot to mention is that, you know, we really need to move away from thinking of food as an expense and start thinking of it as an investment, right? That's what we need to be thinking about. And again, it becomes really difficult when we have an entire economy that's predicated on us understanding that it's an expense and making it very difficult for us to think of it as an investment. But for those of us in this room, anybody who's here, by default, the fact that you're here means that you can afford to think of it as an investment, I promise you, right? We're almost there. Let's talk about it. What can you do? Well, vote with your dollars, of course, right? Create the demand, create the conditions that make this irresistible to farmers, to people who are growing food, to people who want to say, that sounds great, Hewitt, that's beautiful, blah, 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 I can't afford to do that. We need to create the conditions that make them say, okay, I can do that. I must do that. Demand sane food regulations, right? This is one thing I think, and again, I have to keep returning to this, because I think it is right now, I really feel strongly that it is the next barrier that needs to crumble. Don't let insane food regulations stand between you and real food. In other words, break the law. I'm serious, right? It's ridiculous. Encourage others to break the law. Make some noise. That's what we're doing here today. We're making a little noise. We're doing this. Never stop learning. This is one of the other beautiful things about this style of farming or food production or whatever you want to call it. You're learning all the time, right? Acknowledge the connections. between myself and you, between all of us and the soil, right? Realizing we are all one and the same, right? We do not exist in separation. That's a story that's been created for us. And with that, I want to thank you all very much for your time. Awesome questions and comments. Thank you.